build an efficient, loyal, hard-working organization only to find its morale weakened by the personal, financial, and political ambitions of schemers who endeavor to belittle the honest efforts of honest men. For such persons, I only have the utmost scorn and contempt. They are a disgrace to the profession of law enforcement. By their destructive methods, by their underhanded and scurrilous efforts to weaken some honest organization which has aroused their jealousy, they flaunt to the criminal world an invitation to arise in new depredations. They spread the glad word to thief, robber, counterfeiter, and murderer that the underworld has a friend in what should be the palace of stern, honest, efficient, and unswerving justice. It is inevitable that the Federal Bureau of Investigation should be no more immune from such attacks than any other honest force which zealously works for law enforcement. It is inevitable that such detractors, such forces of belittlement, should attempt to use the shortness of public memory in an effort to undermine the efforts of an efficient organization. We have recently heard that it was a shame to kill a nice young man like John Dillinger. We have recently heard from certain sources which should be aligned unalterably with the forces of law enforcement rather than lending aid and comfort to the foul hordes of crime that the special agents of the Federal Bureau of Investigation have a habit of running wild, of shooting men on sight, and of issuing orders to kill this, that, or the other person. There is only one answer and only one way to answer such maliciously untrue statements, and that is to look at the official record. Let us see what is revealed there. In the last few years, the power of gangdom reached such an estate that no family of financial means was safe from kidnapping. The predominant emotion throughout the country was that of fear. The depredations of vicious outlaws roving from state to state like packs of wolves amounted to an actual armed invasion of America. I must remind you that the forces of the underworld today are greater than the entire number of soldiers enlisted for the defense of this country in the World War. At the head of this enormous body of destroyers, there ranges a group so vicious and so dangerous that in the last year alone, it was necessary for local law enforcement officers in the cities and communities of America to kill nearly 400 members of the underworld who, fully armed, sought to cause the death of the officers who came to arrest them. This means that to protect the lives and property of the citizens of this country against a most deadly type of slayer, it was necessary for local law enforcement officers somewhere in the United States to each day, every day of the year, protect their own lives by shooting to kill. With a personnel of less than 600 men, arrayed against a foe numbering in the millions, it has been possible, through careful planning and through highly developed methods of training and study courses, and with active alignment in wholehearted cooperation of local law enforcement agencies for the Federal Bureau of Investigation, to carry on a successful campaign of detection and apprehension of the most deadly characters in the history of American criminality. In only 9 cases, in 3 years, have we found it necessary to shoot and kill dangerous criminals, and then only in the protection of our own lives. We make no excuse for efficient, honest, and straightforward law enforcement. The greatest deterrent to crime is the knowledge on the part of the criminal that there will be sure detection, swift apprehension, and unfailing punishment. And if I may again revert to the subject of youth, there is a necessity that this be made a maxim in every home. Nothing weighs upon me so much as the knowledge that 1 out of 5 of all of our criminals in the United States today is of less than voting age. These boys and girls go to the very door of the penitentiary, believing that in some way they still will be able to defeat the law because through lack of proper education and religious training, they have been allowed to foster the belief that they could make crime pay. The time is come of violator to obtain easy freedom. So many dangerous criminals who have no right whatever to freedom are being turned loose that public sentiment necessarily is outrage against the parole system, when in truth it is not the system which is at fault, but the derelictions of those who administer it. If the proponents of parole really want to help the parole man, then let them do so by working ceaselessly for the eradication of obvious faults. Let them help the parole man along the straight path to reform by keeping the recidivist, the confirmed criminal, the sex pervert, and multiple murderer where he belongs, in prison. The most terrible you to remember always that the future of a criminal must be weighed against the welfare of the community. The needs of society must be considered before the personal wishes of the social offender. Again, common sense must be used. Again, the muddleheads who prate so loudly about things they neither know nor understand must be held in check. There must be a recasting of the public mind toward giving the honest man a better chance to reestablish his position in society by keeping the true enemies of society where they belong and where they deserve to be. We cannot progress, we cannot go forward toward law obedience until we cease our retrogression and start anew upon a plane of understanding, of sincerity, of integrity, efficiency, and education in the all-important field of billing again. What this country so sadly needs, a reverence and respect for the majesty of our laws. For obedience to the law means true liberty. I thank you.
At every gathering of our holy name men, the pledge which we announced at the beginning is pronounced solemnly, that we pledge our support in honor of His divine name to all lawful authority, both civil and religious. And I am sure that when we pronounce this pledge again, we regret that